Thank you for your hospitality, especially to someone who is from the Lost Tribe of Presbyterians, the PCA. I'm glad to be with you. My children asked me yesterday, Papa, why are you going to Memphis? Why are you going to talk to this General Assembly? And the answer is just very simple. I'm here to bear witness, to offer what some traditions refer to as a testimony to the work of the Holy Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in my own very ordinary life. And in my community, Trinity Presbyterian in Charlottesville, Virginia, when somebody offers a testimony, they always end it by saying, "This is what the Lord has done in me." And the congregation says, "Thanks be to God." So let's try that. "This is what the Lord has done in me. Thanks be to God." All right. Well, I say this is what the Lord has done in me, but I have to be honest with you that in my experience, it's been more like what the Lord has done to me. This is what my life has actually felt like, a series of uninvited interventions that have reshaped and continue to reshape the vocation that I thought I had and the vocation that I am now emerging into, the work of my life. And what is the work? What is this work that I am doing? My work is the struggle to heal what I believe to be the central trauma, the central moral, psychological, relational, and structural trauma of American society. The trauma whose daily effect is upon us in very intimate ways. It's on the churches that we serve and it's upon the cities that we share. And what is that trauma? That trauma is, very simply put, the enduring trauma of American white supremacy. And the work of my life is to labor towards the healing of that trauma. And today I want to talk with you about that work, but I want to be clear up front the posture that I'm taking when I'm talking with you about it. I'm not talking to you as an activist. I'm not talking to you as a scholar or an expert. I'm not talking to you as a leader. I'm not even talking to you as a preacher. I'm talking to you today simply as a man whose life has grown increasingly unintelligible, even as its central burden has become increasingly clear to me. I'm talking to you today as a brother on an unforeseen pilgrimage, whose source, I believe, is the suffering of Christ, whose goal, I believe, is the kingdom of Christ, and whose consolation along the way is the friendship of Christ. I want to talk to you, in other words, about what the Lord has done in me, what he's doing to me and in me. And because I want to talk about this in terms of trauma and healing, I'm gonna walk us through this pilgrimage in four different ways. There's these four stages. I'm gonna talk about the wounding, I'm gonna talk about the healing, I'm gonna talk about the calling, and I'm gonna talk about the yearning. And that's what we're gonna do. So first, the wounding. When I say the wounding, I'm speaking here about the time when I first was cognizant of the experience of being wounded by our cultural inheritance of white supremacy. It was a wound that at the time was strangely invisible, but at the same time it was catastrophic. And here's what happened. I was in fourth grade in a small town in South Carolina where I grew up. And fourth grade, above all times, is a time for boys to be boys. We ran and we played. And my best friend during that time was an African-American boy named, ironically, Greg. And we were known as the two Gregs. And in the way that only boys can know each other, I knew his run. I knew his hands. I knew what it was like when he threw a baseball. I knew that he was always going to have the milk stuck on the side of his lips. I can see those things now, thinking back on my time as a little boy. And we were known as the two Gregs, and we did everything together. And we were, for all practical purposes, we were the same. Until the moment when we weren't the same. I remember we were sitting in our little classroom, we were talking in our class, and the teacher called us down, as often happened to the two of us. And something about the way she called us down struck him as funny. You ever have one of these unwilled moments when you should not be laughing at something, but you are going to laugh at something? Something about the way that she corrected him struck him as funny. He let out this unwilled snort of laughter and tried to cover it up. And that's when it happened. In an instant, my fourth grade teacher came across the room. She grabbed him by the front of his shirt, picked him up, threw him against the chalkboard, and in front of our whole class said to him, and forgive me, I'm going to quote her, "Why don't you wipe that nigger smile off your face?" I remember in that moment being gripped by something that I'd never known before, what can only be called a form of horror. horror at my teacher's twisted face, horror at the confusing violence that was taking shape among us, horror at the look of flushed helplessness and shame on my friend's face. I was horrified for him as I sat at my desk. But in a way that I could not yet articulate, I was also horrified for myself. I was horrified that I had gotten away with something that he had not. I was horrified by the flickers of unwilled satisfaction, that new sense of superiority that was somehow welling up inside of me. I was horrified at my own silence, at his embarrassment. And I was horrified by the sense that this gulf had somehow opened between us, that it had been torn open by someone else, but it was between us, and so it had. I remember going out into the playground for recess after this event, and I found my friend over on the edge of the blacktop, just sort of down on one knee, drawing in the dirt. And I walked over, and I knelt down directly in front of him, and I had no idea what to say to him. And he looked down, and we both looked down, and I just watched his tears pattern the dirt in front of me. And it was like the first emergence of the color line in my life. He was on one side, I was on the other. And that is the last memory that I have of him. I don't remember ever being with him again. Certainly we were there for the rest of the year. Certainly we would have gone on to fifth grade together. But something in that moment tore our friendship apart. But as traumatic as these things were, and in spite of how deeply I felt them at the moment, they were actually not the sum of the trauma. For the blow that had struck him so visibly had struck me also, but also invisibly. And somewhere inside of my 9-year-old heart, a moral bruise had begun to bloom. A cataract had begun to form that fundamentally shaped how I saw and how I failed to see reality. It shaped the way that I saw him. For the first time, I was cognizant that my friend was black. And I knew somehow from what my teacher had done that being black must mean that something is wrong with him, that he was somehow less valuable, less trustworthy, less worthy of protection, that it was somehow okay to humiliate him and hold even his smile in contempt. I didn't want to see him that way. I didn't cultivate seeing him that way, but I started in a slight way to see him in that way. It shaped how I saw myself in like manner. It was the first time I was ever conscious of being white. And that being white meant somehow that you were better and that you got treated differently, that you were somehow more worthy of respect, that it was somehow normal for me to be protected from both the humiliation and the consequences of my own actions. Again, I didn't want to see myself in this way, but I did. I began to assume these things. And lastly, it shaped how I saw the world. This experience in fourth grade became a subterranean baseline for me of how I understood the world that I was in. The world, as I experienced it in that classroom, as I now heard it in the jokes at my family gatherings and the shows that we watched and the politicians that we supported and the coded language that they used and in the churches that we attended, it was a world where people like me were good and normal and entitled, and people who were not like me, especially African Americans, were somehow, even though this was never said, they were somehow suspect or threatening or less worthy of honor. None of this was conscious to me, and none of this was cultivated by me. It was more, as I said, like a subterranean moral instinct whose currents began invisibly and yet powerfully to press my sense of reality into the shape of what I believe to be white supremacy, which is, when I use this language, some of you were thinking about hoods and torches, and that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about a basic assumption that I, as a white person, was somehow superior in all the institutions of my life for reinforcing that fact. And that those currents began to inoculate me to any other vision of the world. That, for me, was the origin, as far as I can tell, of this wounding, of the personal onset of what is a larger social trauma. And I believe that that wound is reproduced in each of us every day. And for many of us, this has happened to us our entire lives. That is the wounding. Do you know that wound? Have you experienced this in your own life? Because what I'm describing to you is not atypical. It's a very basic fact of existence. But God, because he is good, did not leave me in the wounding. He began to move me into what I want to talk about now as the healing. And when I say the healing, I'm speaking about the time in which and the long process through which God began to heal me from that event and all of the constellation of events that supported it and reinforced it, and also began to show me what it meant for this larger issue to be healed in my life and in the larger community. And I want to talk about this as a slow opening of a camera lens, or it slowly gets wider and you slowly see more and more and more. That's what it's been like for me. And I'm going to talk about this in kind of four different dimensions of healing, four what I would experience as stages, but they all go together. The first is personal, the sense of personal healing that needed to happen. And this really came through my father. My father is was a construction worker in South Carolina. He is, by no even conceivable stretch of anyone's imagination, a radical. But my father, in a small town in South Carolina, was deeply opposed to the racist assumptions that he saw around him. And we were the poor white family that lived on the edge of the black neighborhood, which meant that we had a basketball goal. That was one of the differences. And so all the guys came to our house to play basketball. My dad coached them in sports. I remember him protecting them. I remember him staring people down in the crowd when people in the crowd would say things that were inappropriate. My dad began to instill in me in a very unconscious but very real way when I was young, the sense that I had a personal responsibility to renounce these kinds of assumptions, which are just a part of the culture in which we grew up. That personal transformation to say, and that awakened in me the sense of, oh, this is not right. I didn't know what to do about that, but I had a very sense, a real sense from my father that I needed to change, that the way that I assumed things about the world needed to be undone, and that something else that was more beautiful needed to be put in its place. So the personal was the first part. But then there became this relational dimension. And this happened when I converted to Christianity when I was 15. I was going to a Presbyterian church in Greenville, South Carolina, and the pastor of that church at the time was now an EPC pastor named John Wood. And I went and listened to John Wood preach, and I had never heard anything like that in my entire life. And he was completely blowing my mind, talking about all of the way the gospel impacted culture and all kinds of things. And I became a Christian in that context. And as a part of my conversion to Christianity, a part of the youth group world that I was in, racial reconciliation was a part of it. This was the mid-80s, and so racial reconciliation ministries were taking place. And so very, very early in my life and work as a Christian, I understood the Christian gospel not just to be about my own personal transformation, but about relational repair. That is to say, I needed to go and find friendships and build friendships across racial lines, which I did in my high school, on trips, on basketball teams. And this, for me, was a part of the outworking of my faith, that racial reconciliation was what needed to happen. And many of you use this language, and many of you are right now involved in these ministries, and you're right to be so. But that wasn't enough, because I eventually came to a third dimension of this healing, and what I'm going to refer to not as the personal or the relational, but as the institutional element of this trauma. Now, I had been very excited by what I learned from John Wood and from Reformed pastors around the world, and when I went to Covenant Seminary, I went because I was very interested in the way that the Christian faith can transform culture. I went to be at the Francis Schaeffer Institute on Christianity and Culture. I was very excited about these things. I was thinking about structures, I was thinking about the arts, I was thinking about economics, all kinds of things. It was a completely thrilling way to pursue a theological education. At that time, I was exposed to the writings of Leslie Newbegin. Some of you certainly have been exposed to him and how he was seeking to engage late modern Western culture with the gospel as a missionary. And that was completely inspiring to me. And I thought, this is exactly what I want to do. But I had not yet made the connection between the structures that I was seeking to change through creation, fall, redemption, consummation, through God's making new of all things, and the American racial experience I had had. I had not made that connection. For me, race was still something about reconciliation. But the structures were about something else. It was about modernity or secularism or something like that. And during that time, I was working at a rescue mission in downtown St. Louis. And I was teaching a 13-month men's residential program. These guys were mostly court appointees to this program. I was teaching in that. And this guy said to me one day, he was a 22-year-old person who had been remanded to this program out of the penitentiary for gang violence, but they were trying to give him a start over. And he said to me, GT, that's what he called me, that's what everybody calls me, GT, we know that you love us, but we also know that you can leave. We know that you love us, but we also know that you can leave. And when you leave and go on with your life, your white life, our lives are going to be the same. Because it's not about what's happening in here. It's what's happening out here. That moment from that 22-year-old in front of me, man in front of me, was the first time in my life that I had begun to integrate my deep concern and interest in social structures and institutions with the question of race. That was the first time. I had not understood that before. I had not seen that, oh, this is not just about a history, and my making African-American friends is not somehow sufficient to heal this trauma. There are actual institutions that we need to understand and to engage. So the personal, the relational, the institutional. And then the fourth dimension that has been the last 15 years of my life is what I'm going to call the civilizational horizon of white supremacy. Understanding the civilizational horizon of white supremacy. When I went to Charlottesville, Virginia, I left St. Louis, moved to Charlottesville, Virginia, did a campus ministry, but I wanted to give myself to these questions of religion and culture and what it meant for faith-based communities, for Christian churches to engage, redemptively engage the culture in which we live. And so I did two things in order to explore that vocation. One, I became the senior pastor of a church, Trinity Presbyterian in Charlottesville, Virginia, where I was for 11 years. And the other thing I did was a master's and a PhD at UVA in theology, ethics, and culture. I wanted to understand the theoretical side, and I also wanted to understand the lived theology side very practically inside of the congregation. And I was always tacking back and forth between those two things. And it was a completely thrilling, if exhausting, experience. This is why I look the way I do. It was so tiring. When I went to do my PhD, I was very interested in the role of churches and how they can impact their cultural life. And so I thought, well, who should I study to do this? Well, maybe I'll do Augustine. Augustine would be awesome. But then I realized, I'm not really ready to be a scholar of the ancient world. I don't really know all those languages, so I don't think I want to do that. And then I thought, okay, well, maybe I'll do Calvin. So I spent a year working on Calvin's political theology, and I thought, gosh, that's a little cliche for the Presbyterian guy to do Calvin. So let's not do that. Then I thought, all right, well, who else? What is another religious figure that has sought to engage a social order that was in crisis? Oh, Bonhoeffer. I will do Dietrich Bonhoeffer. So I spent a year working on Dietrich Bonhoeffer, getting inside, reading his papers, reading ethics, going through the cost of discipleship, reading Life Together about 100 times. And then I thought, I don't know that I want to be a 20th century intellectual German historian. That's what this is going to require me to be. And I'm kind of not great at German either. So there's that. And I was at, thank you, brother. And so I was thinking, I was on vacation. I had just finished my comprehensive exams. And I was on vacation in Chattanooga with my wife. And I walked into this bookstore and said, all right, I'm just going to get a book and to read over these next 2 weeks of vacation. And I picked up this book by John Meacham on the American Civil Rights Movement. It was called Voices in Our Blood. And it was firsthand accounts of the Civil Rights Movement. And I went up to the cabin where we were staying, and the first article I read was an Atlantic article about a lynching that had happened in my hometown in 1948. And the second thing that I read was an interview with Martin Luther King Jr. about the role of love in transforming American society. And I decided, sitting there in a cabin on Lookout Mountain, that I was going to do my PhD on Martin Luther King's theology of love. I didn't know anything about Martin Luther King. I mean, I knew the kind of the public mythologies about Martin Luther King. I knew that something about the dream speech. I couldn't have told you anything else really about him. But I came back and told my professors, I want to continue to work on this notion of the faith-based community seeking to engage culture in turmoil, but what I want to do is focus on the African-American church, specifically on Martin Luther King and 20th century America. And they said, all right, go for it. And the added bonus was it was all in English. So there's that. So I spent nearly 10 years during this process studying African-American intellectual history, American social history, the history of American political conflict, the life of Martin Luther King Jr., the history of the Civil Rights Movement and all of its various forms, Reconstruction forward. And during those studies, the insight that I had originally gotten from that 22-year-old man in St. Louis came back to me, and it exploded in my head. And I began to see that the social structures of late modernity, structures that I was so interested in as a scholar and a pastor, teaching my classes on Leslie Newbegin and on the cultural renewal of all things. All of these social structures, whether it's the economy or whether it's education or housing, all of these things that I cared about were indivisible in this country from the history of white supremacy. Personhood, the notion of personhood. There has been a systematic history in the United States of the denial of black personhood. That is why the I am a man signs were printed in Memphis in 1968. And some of you went to Clayborn Temple and you saw the I am a man plaza that we worked on last year to reassert African-American humanity. Let's think about economics, systems of exploitation and theft. Let's think about criminal justice. Let's talk about housing. We could talk about redlining. We could talk about education, inequity, and funding. We could talk about medical care, where the average life expectancy in African-American community in the United States is 12 years lower than an analogous white community in this country. We could talk about religion. We could talk about my own tradition and the Presbyterian tradition and its complicity in these things. And I didn't know this. And I was on a farm writing, doing a bunch of research and writing for my dissertation. I had to take these 2-week breaks to go and write. And I was in this old farmhouse, which had been on a plantation in South Carolina, this old cabin. And I remember I would have these 16-hour days by myself because I've got 4 kids and I really needed to make the most of everything, every time I have to write. And I would sit all day and I would read the history of African-American slavery. I just read all day. And I remember after 2 weeks, I pushed my chair back and I said something that I absolutely believe, and I want you to understand that what I'm about to say, my realization in that moment, I am not exaggerating what I think to be true, for effect. I came to believe that it was undeniable that America was the longest standing white supremacist social order in history, and that I was a Christian pastor in that order. Now, it was undeniable that there are good things in the United States, so please don't think I'm like reducing American history to just this. I'm not. But it was undeniably the case that I was a citizen in and a Christian pastor in the longest standing white supremacist social order in history. Nothing else even comes close. Apartheid is 45 years. We're dealing with over 300 years. And I believe that I could no longer talk about what it means to be a missional church apart from this issue. Just like it wouldn't make sense for me to go to Rwanda and want to be a missional church and not talk about a genocide. Just like it would not make sense for me to go to South Africa and not talk about apartheid. You see, it just didn't make any sense for me to continue to persist in all of my aspirations to be a missional church and to not talk about this. Now, this insight bloomed into what I now believe is a calling. And here's the third part. So we've talked about the wounding, the healing. And I want to talk about the calling. This calling that is confusing and awkward and not fully intelligible to me right now in my own life, but it is undeniable. I believed and came to believe and now believe standing before you that my work as a man and as a missionary Christian is to try to heal American culture from this central moral, psychological, relational, and social trauma. That is my work. So when people ask me what I do, I don't know what to say. But people ask me why I do what I do, that's what I say. I believe that it is part of my work in the world to try to heal American culture from this central trauma that is destroying us. Now, how did I do that? Well, it's been complicated. But I started in my church. I was a pastor, as I said. I thought, I have to begin with my local congregation. How do I do this? How do I work this out in a local congregation of mostly educated social elites in a town with only an 18% minority population? How do I do this in a world where white supremacy doesn't even seem to be real and the white academic liberalism around me is so smug and assumes that it's not in any way implicated in all this? How do I do that? Well, what I did is I remembered, I began to think, all right, what are the things that allowed white supremacy to exist? Let me understand those, and then I'll try to take those three on, okay? And here's what they are: ignorance, extraction, and control. Those three things are what allows white supremacy to exist. Ignorance, extraction, and control. Ignorance, that is to say, I realized that many of my beloved people had no idea about the history of white supremacy in the United States. They thought that was a group of people who were off in the woods in North Carolina somewhere doing weird stuff. They had no idea of the social and economic and housing and medical, and none of it. And I realized, oh, if ignorance is the issue, then I need to do education, because I understood that my congregation knew more about the church in Iran than they do about the black church in their own town. And tell me if that is not universally the case. And so I began to just educate my people. I began to talk about, I taught a class on the history of the black church. I used sermon illustrations predominantly from African-American communities. I talked about and quoted and asked my people to read African-American theologians. I knew that they could tell me more 17th century English theologians than living African-American theologians. And I bet that's true of 95% of the people in the room. And that's just how it works. The whole thing of white supremacy was not for white people to hate black people, it was for us to ignore them, to not see them, to not know anything about them. And so I began to do the work of education. And I began to talk about our role as a denomination in the history of America. What about extraction? Well, I realized that white supremacy was basically a form of extraction, that we took things that did not belong to us, that we took out of communities. And African-American communities are decimated across the United States precisely for these reasons. And the history of this is incontrovertible. I mean, it's really beyond controversy at this point. So what do we do as a church? Well, the antidote to extraction is investment. And we began to think about our local missions budget as almost a repair fund, as a reinvestment fund in the African-American community in our city. So meeting ignorance with education, extraction with investment. And the last part is control. The way white supremacy continues is that white people are always in control of institutions. We're always the ones setting the table. We're always the ones setting the terms. We write the policy manuals. This is true, broadly speaking. And I realized that in order for me in my own life to overcome that I needed to meet that with renunciation, to meet control with renunciation. And I knew that there was no way that minority voices would ever be able to lead at my church as long as I was there. And so I resigned. And I still go to our church, and it's wonderful, and people don't treat me as like the real pastor. People don't even talk to me about church stuff. The elders were awesome. They said, we just want to let these folks be Christian people here. Can you just leave them alone? And the church did, which is amazing. And they hired a Korean, and they offered the senior pastor job to an African-American but they did that around August 12th of last year. I'm not sure if you remember what was happening in Charlottesville around August 12th last year. Namely, the Klan was walking through our town with torches, and a woman was killed. And so the African-American pastor said, I'm not really ready to bring my family into this. So he said no. So they've been in this search process. But I knew that I had to meet ignorance with education, extraction with investment, and control with renunciation. And that is how I began to work this out in the church. And it was very confusing for me, and it was very confusing for my people. Like, why is he leaving? We don't understand. And I didn't fully understand, but I understood that as long as I was standing there, that other people who needed to stand there couldn't be there. And that moved me from working directly in the church to working on these issues in the culture at large. Some of this was prompted by the shootings in Charleston at Mother Emanuel Church. A few weeks after the Mother Emanuel shootings, you all remember this, yes? Somebody called me and said, hey, some African-American evangelical leaders want to get together with some white evangelical leaders, and you're the only one that we know has done a background in civil rights stuff, and nobody really knows you, but would you come to this thing? And when I went, I showed up, and a group of these African-American leaders said to me, we want to hear you talk tomorrow, which made me almost barf. Well, we want to hear you talk tomorrow. And I said, what do you want to hear me talk about? And they said, we want to understand what is happening with white people. I was like, that's fairly broad. and they said, no, we want you to do the work to help us understand this. And that was the first time I had ever spoken about my own story to anybody. I told them about the story of my friend Greg. I told them that my grandfather was in the Klan. It's the first time I'd ever talked about any of these things. And when I was done, they said, "We don't know you, but whatever you're doing right now, you need to stop, and you need to come help us as we are partnering to heal America from this trauma." And I didn't know what that would mean, but I knew that, you know, by principle of analogy, I needed to move into American culture and address the same three things that I had to address in my church, which are ignorance, extraction, and control. So, ignorance. How am I seeking to re-educate the American population about the history of white supremacy? That's a little bit of a daunting task. Well, the way that I'm doing it right now is through public art. Some of you went to Clayborn Temple yesterday. You saw the I Am a Man Plaza. You went into that building. Some of you will know that I helped to write and produce a musical about the sanitation workers' strike that was performed at the 50th anniversary of King's assassination. I feel like we have to use these public art installations like the I Am a Man Plaza, like the musical Union, like a memorial to the Underground Railroad workers that I'm working on in Kennett Square, Pennsylvania right now. We have to awaken the American public to the history of these things, and to do it not through direct political confrontation, which just shuts people down in this tribal culture in which we live, but to do it through the power of art, to say, here is what is true, and here's how we together can address this. So I'm working on this issue of ignorance by trying to renew the imagination through these public arts and through writing and things like that. Extraction. What do we do about that? Well, for the past couple of years, I've been working in the social impact investment world. Some of you will know about investments. Social impact investment is a form of investment that's growing in the United States economy at roughly $100 billion, where investment are now seeking to invest not just in meaningful businesses, but in institutions that are going to help impact positively and socially repair the damage that white supremacy has done. That's just one part of social impact investing. And so, 2 years ago, when I was working at Thriving Cities, we built a tool to help investors and churches understand how their dollars could bring real impact in the community. And for the past year, I've been working for somebody in Philadelphia, building a social impact investment company for them. And so I think that the reinvestment of resources is critical to healing this, because listen to me, evangelical Christians, white supremacy is not about what's going on just in your heart and about racial reconciliation as friends. It is about institutional repair. And as somebody said to me one time, an African-American friend said, "We didn't march through the streets of Birmingham so we could be friends with you." That was so helpful. And I said, "Why did you march?" He said, "Because we want our children to live. And we want the institutions that transform and sustain our children's lives to be healthy. And the way that that can happen is by people like you," that is, say me, "taking the resources and capital that you have and reinvesting it." I mean, look, any six-year-old would know that if you said to them, tell them a story, "Hey, I want to tell you a story about a community that took this other community and made them slaves and took all of their money and then kept them from ever getting economically ahead. What would you do?" Any six-year-old you ask them, you know what they would say? "Well, then you need to give that back." That's what they would say. This is not complicated. This is not even morally complicated at all. Now, how one does repair is complicated, because there are all sorts of social entailments. But that complication is not a reason to not figure this out. And so we have to do not just renewing the imagination and overcoming ignorance. We have to do reinvestment. We have to do reinvestment. And we cannot satisfy ourselves, white Christians, that because we have some black friends, we're good. We're not. Because our neighbors are not. And now, control. How am I working out control? Well, I think it has to be about renunciation. I was with some guys last night, and they were joking with me, like, why don't you speak anymore? Where are your books? It's like, why aren't you doing that? Well, part of it is because I believe that for the time being, there are other voices that need to be heard. And this is really about the only speaking engagement that I have done in some time and will do for some time. Because I need to step out of the spotlight and let other people's voices be heard. And I am now moving my family to Memphis, and I'm going to work for an African-American woman, amazing leader named Anasa Troutman, who does these kind of public art installations around social impact, and I'm giving all of my resources and life to supporting her work. I don't really know how this is going to go, and it feels like totally weird, because for a long time I've been used to being the person that does things like this, that stands in front and says, let us help you think about, you know, American culture or pluralism or secularism or the history of white supremacy or blah, blah, blah. And now I'm entering into what I believe is a sort of silent period where I am giving my gifts to help other people speak who need to be heard more than I need to be heard. And so I'm moving my family to Memphis in 3 weeks, leaving Charlottesville, Virginia, where we've been for 18 years, moving into a three-bedroom apartment downtown with my four kids, and trying to give ourselves here in this amazing city, 65% African-American city, to healing the trauma of white supremacy. And I think Memphis is a great place to go with that work. Now, where is this going to lead? I don't know. I don't even know if I'm doing the right thing, and I sure don't even know how to do what I'm doing, okay? There is no expertise here, okay? These are improvisations of love that are very confusing and may fail. But what is it that I'm yearning for? And this is the last thing I want to say to you. We talk about the wounding, the healing, the calling, and now the yearning. I want to be healed. I want all of my presumptions of entitlement to be gone. And I want to see that my life is for my neighbor and that that is how I dwell in and with Christ. And so I want every trace of this trauma gone. I want the church to be healed. I want the church to be healed, to be empowered and courageous to directly and deliberately address one of the great scourges of late modern society, to stop using euphemisms, to stop politely avoiding this conflict with silence, to stop persuading ourselves that if we've just talked about how the gospel means that we're more sinful than we ever thought and we're more loved than we ever thought, that we have therefore said the fullness of the gospel. I want us to stop that. And I want us to see that we are missionaries inside of a nation state. And that nation state has been characterized by one of the greatest tragedies in American history. And I want us to have the courage to say, we see it, we see our complicity inside of it. We have the intellectual and institutional and economic and relational resources to address it. And that is what we are gonna do. That's what I wanna see. But I also want to see our nation healed, because for me, this is fundamentally not about the church. This is about the neighbor. And I will say honestly to you that one of my great griefs as a pastor is that I went to the church to get to the neighbor, and I could never get to the neighbor because I was stuck inside of political squabbles all of the time. And so I left. Because my calling is to love my neighbor in Jesus' name. And I want to see our nation healed. I want you to call in front of your imaginations the misery that is happening in cities across the United States, what King called the psychological damage, the economic deprivation, the violence, the life expectancy, the poverty, the self-hatred, the estrangement. These are fundamental to the American social experiment, to our life together. And I want to see Jesus heal those. I want to see Jesus use the church and whatever other means he wants to heal those things, because this is a trauma that needs to be healed. And I don't know what it will look like, and I certainly don't know how long it will take, and I don't know even the best way to do it, but I do have an image of what I think it will look like. When I was on that farm down in South Carolina writing, and I had that realization, oh my Lord, for all the goodness of our national identity, and there is real goodness, this is an undeniable reality that I have not addressed. I kind of freaked out, found it to be totally overwhelming. And so I thought, what should I do? Well, I should go to church, that's what I should do. So I went online, and I looked for the closest African-American church near me. And I drove, it was Greater St. Paul Missionary Baptist Church. And I drove down, and I drove into the parking lot, and I was nervous. And, you know, people were understandably nervous. A white guy in South Carolina showing up to a black church. People were nervous. And I'm not like your average friendly-looking white guy. You know, I'm people see me, they're like, okay, he's kind of scary-looking. I mean, right? So I walk into the church, and I take a seat in the kind of near the back. I'm just kind of waving. And hello, good to see you. And this deacon comes over to me, and he says, our pastor would like to see you. Okay. So I walk back through the halls to his office, and he's sitting at his desk, and he motions to me to sit down, and he said, we welcome people. Any person is welcome in this church, but I'd like to know who you are and what brings you to our church today. And it was at that moment I realized the kind of moral seriousness that they were taking, the fact that I was there. And I said, well, I'm writing my dissertation on King, and I'm just staying at a farm up the road, and I need to be with Christians. And he said, you know, my favorite King speech is, and he began to quote this, and I quoted it back to him, and he said, you are all right, my brother. And so so he says, just go on back out, and make sure we greet one another after the service. So we walk out into the service, and I'm sitting there, and there are some hilarious moments where I basically reinforced every stereotype of white awkwardness that you can have, including when he came in and he sat down on the stage and he said, I'd like to begin the service by asking if there are any visitors among us. I was just totally played, so I stood up. And he did the most amazing thing, and he said, brothers and sisters, this is Reverend Thompson. He knows our history, he knows our stories, and he is giving himself to the work of Martin Luther King. And people were like, okay. And so, he said in front of everybody, he said to me, brother, you must be at home among us. And then we went through the service, and at the end of the service, everybody started getting up. The service hadn't officially ended, but everybody just started getting up from their chairs, and I had no idea what to do. And they were forming a line at the back, at the aisle at the back of the church. And so I sat there because I wasn't sure what was happening. And this guy came and got me, and he said, you need to come on. And I said, what are we doing? He said, we're doing a love feast. I was like, okay. I don't know what that is, but that sounds fun. So we all got in this line at the back of the church, and the two pastors were down at the front, and they had bread and wine. And we were all, and there were probably 300 of us just piled in the back. And this young woman, maybe 14 years old, she stepped out in front of the whole group. And she said, give him the praise. And the whole congregation went, Father, give him the praise. Son, give him the praise. Holy Spirit, give him the praise. Three in one. That's how it started. And I was just immediately a wreck. And then she started again. Give him the praise, Father. And the whole congregation started walking two by two down this aisle, singing that over and over. And we got to the end of the aisle, and I didn't know what to do. And they said, they gave me the bread and gave her the wine. I broke it. I gave it to the woman beside me. We both ate. She took a sip. I took a sip, and then she gave me a hug, and she said, this is a love feast. And at that moment, I thought, this moment right here, this is what my life is about. People who have been estranged for all kinds of reasons coming together inside the life of the Trinity, partaking of the body and the blood, healed, and leaving together. That's it. And I am now in pursuit of that moment. I don't know how I'm going to get there. I don't know what it will entail, but I know that this is where I am going. And I want to tell you this today, that brothers and sisters, this is what the Lord has done in me. Thanks be to God. Thank you.
got a lot of questions for you. What are your thoughts about the push to remove the statue of Thomas Jefferson from the UVA campus? Helpful, necessary, or counterproductive?
Thanks for starting off with a softball. I think the issue of memorialization is very complicated. And I'll say this, I don't have a very clear like policy on this. I think the removal of some of the Confederate statues in the United States is absolutely appropriate because the history of when these were placed there, for example, the Robert E. Lee statue and the Andrew Jackson statue in Charlottesville, they were placed in 1917. This is clearly at the height of the Jim Crow era. This is a part of a larger architectural reinforcement of white rule. There just is no question about the history of these statues, and I believe that those things should be either taken down or, as people in Charlottesville, I think the most thoughtful people in Charlottesville have said, they need to be recontextualized inside of a truer story. My concern about them being taken away totally is that it tends towards a self-righteous community that can forget what its possibilities are. It can forget who it is, and we can say, oh, we're just going to erase all these things. And I think people that erase their sins rather than repenting of their sins become a self-righteous, morally impaired people. And so that's my general approach, and how we recontextualize those things, I don't have a clear answer, and that needs to be, I think, in my judgment, locally and artistically decided in with collaboration among communities. Thomas Jefferson, I think, is a slightly different story in the sense that his statue was not erected during the kind of highlight of the Jim Crow era. It was before that. But I think what UVA is doing right now is being very honest about the legacy of slavery and white supremacy. As many of you will know, that Monticello just opened an exhibit, a permanent exhibit, with Sally Hemings and her entire family. UVA is doing extensive research on slavery at the University of Virginia and Thomas Jefferson's complicity of that. They're doing, I think, a version of recontextualization, and we'll see how it goes. But I think that is a very important strategy, and I think the issue is not to erase history for me, it's to tell the truth. And to tell the truth with an eye that we can forgive one another, and that even our heroes are deeply flawed. And I think that's a very important reminder. I think the days of cultish American nationalist heroes need to be over. And what we need to do is say that this is a nation of women and men who fail and who also succeed. And let's honor the good and repent of the bad. And that seems to me to be a Christian ethic of public memorial. That's how I'm thinking about it, at least.
Thanks.
But I don't know.
Could you please talk to us about some reinvestment strategies that could be employed by a local church?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think local churches, especially in the context of your local mission budget, you have a lot of opportunity here. And what I think you could do, and again, this isn't, well, I'm thinking too many things. What I think you could do is begin to partner with your city government, with your African-American colleagues, churches, with nonprofits, to do a real assessment of where the greatest social needs in your community are, and what kind of institutions are needed, healthy institutions are needed to address those. You could assess the health of the institutions in your community. And then what are the key performance indicators you ought to be looking for? So for example, if you're like, hey, we really feel like education is a huge deal. How do we change education? Well, what you do is you begin to look for key performance indicators, like, for example, third grade reading level. A lot of people see that as a really great key performance indicator. And then you target your investment around creating strategies to move that key performance indicator forward, and you measure your impact over time. And you do that in partnership. I think that in your city, in most cases, your city already knows what the biggest needs are. They can tell you what the statistical variables are. They can tell you where the targeted needs are. And I think the churches have a lot of resources to actually target those things institutionally, and to do so generally, I think, in partnership. It's the case that churches are, by and large, providing already most of the volunteer support for ministers in your church. I don't know if you've ever seen that Onion headline that said, group of brainwashed idiots feeds local homeless. And basically it was a recognition of, hey, we make fun of the church a lot, but these are the people that are doing all the work. And I think that's really true. So you're already doing the volunteer work. But I think taking the financial work and thinking, how can we be more strategic in our investment? And I think that in my case, that required me growing in the knowledge of how investments work and also getting people who care about that and saying, what if we began to invest, and then that returned capital, and then the people that where capital's returned, we could then reinvest that again. So I think being smarter about our philanthropic strategies and our local investment strategies is really, really critical, because we're, in my judgment, we spend roughly $700 billion a year in the American economy on philanthropic endeavors. And Memphis, for example, is, I think when I checked last year, it was the second highest per capita philanthropic city in the United States, behind Salt Lake City. And yet there is also a 33% child poverty rate. That says to me that we're dealing with allocations of resources that need to be more disciplined, and I think churches ought to take a lead in doing that.
Thank you. How do I speak lovingly to my friends who think that white supremacy doesn't exist?
I think in my experience, forms of denial are usually rooted in fear. And I think being very conscious of that pastorally when we're talking to people, I mean, listen, I live in a town that is as self-righteous as you can be in terms of liberalism. It is just, you know, like all this woman got killed in our town, and all my neighbors were holding up signs that said, "Not my Charlottesville." And I'm thinking, what are you talking about? Of course this is your Charlottesville. This is my Charlottesville. This is a town built by slaves. How can we conceal our own history inside of our self-righteousness? So I think that we have to be very, very attentive to what are the moral and psychological and emotional dimensions to this when people are talking about it. I'm not saying we need to coddle white people. I am saying that if we want to have constructive conversations, not shaming people, because shame doesn't change anybody for the good, understanding that there are fears going on, and I just think it takes a lot of work. And in my case, it is getting people to read things. And I think once you begin seriously to do the work of looking at American intellectual history and cultural history and economic realities, I think once you begin to do the work, it stretches the border even of fantasy to say mm-hmm. that white supremacy doesn't exist. And I think it's, for me, helping people to see that when I'm talking about white supremacy, I am not fundamentally talking about an affective disorder, which is to say something going on inside of my heart. I'm talking about a social and institutional structural reality. And I think helping people see that, and then also helping people have some analogies to that, because the same people who would say that, in my experience, are people who would be very interested in supporting IJM, you know, International Justice Ministry on slavery and human trafficking, or they're very concerned about what's going on in Nicaragua, things like that. And I think helping them see by analogy that the things that they care about in missions overseas, the things that make them cry at mission conferences, are in fact happening in their own country. And I think helping people see that is important. I'll say one more thing about this, it may be helpful. We used to have a joke on our pastoral staff that there was a portal in the middle of the Atlanta-Hartsfield Airport. And what we mean is that people would leave Charlottesville thinking, there is social inequity is made up by liberals, it's a communist plot or whatever. Then they would fly out of Hartsfield and go to Grenada, Nicaragua, where children are being trafficked, where women are not employed, where there's a 75% sexual assault rate. And they would work on schools, on starting businesses, on starting medical clinics, all that kind of stuff, because they saw these structural realities and it broke their heart. But then they would fly back into the Atlanta airport through some invisible portal, and all of that would go away. Mm. It would suddenly be framed by the American, like, this is all liberalism. Yeah. And so we realized, we need to not fly through Atlanta anymore, right? There's some sense of, like, when they were there, they knew that they were missionaries trying to solve profound social crises. When they came back, they were under siege of liberalism. And we thought, wait, we have to help them make that connection and see that asymmetry of thought. And I think that's been useful.
Yeah. Thanks. You mentioned using illustrations and readings from non-white theologians. What are some of the books you suggest for people who should start to listen to educate ourselves and those in our congregation?
Thank you for that question. I would say a really useful book that you could just start with personally is a book called Children of Fire by Thomas Holt, A History of African Americans, Children of Fire. That will give you a broad sweep, and some of the stories in there will, just crush you. And I think that's helpful. And you can talk about that book with people, just in terms of getting the context. But in terms of, my congregation used to laugh at me. I mean, I think they were so glad in some ways that I resigned because they were so sick of talking about Martin Luther King, I'll tell you that. But for me, I thought that King was incredibly helpful because he was explicitly using theological categories that were familiar to our people, especially in the prophetic tradition. And so King, also Howard Thurman, was someone, he wrote a book called Jesus and the Disinherited. He was an interesting, that's one of the books, by the way, that was in King's briefcase when he was killed. Hmm. He was a very interesting early 20th century African-American theologian. He was like mystically inclined, but also socially inclined. So he was a very powerful person. So I would think getting inside of King's work, and there's a book called A Testament of Hope, which is essentially a collection of King's writings, A Testament of Hope. And if you just start to make your way through that, you'll find yourself underlining lots and lots of things. I think, oh man, I love that. So I would probably start there, and then, you know, as Robert Frost says, way leads on to way, and then you'll end up finding things in the bibliography that would be really helpful.
What's the best first practical step for a predominantly white church to reach out to its community, whether it be a predominantly white community or a predominantly black community?
Well, I think thinking about the when I describe the healing in terms of these concentric stages, you know, the personal, and then the relational, and then the institutional, and then the last one I call the civilizational. I think for me that became a grid to assess kind of where we were. And some people in our congregation just need to open this up, this part of their heart up, because a lot of us are very, very scared about this and very resentful of this, and we're tired of being bashed on for being white and all of these kind of things. And I can tell that there's something that closes up inside of us. In fact, in my neighborhood about a month ago, somebody had driven around in the middle of the night and thrown onto each driveway a Ziploc bag with a rock and a piece of paper inside of it, and it said, "It's okay to be white." They threw that on everybody's driveway. And I think I saw that and I thought, I understand why people are saying this, right? Because you think, okay, this is just gonna be one more like white male bashing session. So I think that helping people go through the personal part and say, wait a minute, am I afraid of this? Do I trust Christ with this? What does Jesus need to teach me? Is his own sort of spiritual practice that we have to cultivate? And for some of our churches, that's just where we need to be, and that's great. Others are prepared to go more relationally and begin to say, all right, well, let's build a relationship with African-American churches, or let's talk to our congregation members who are non-white and ask them what their experience is here, and then really listen to them and say, what would you change here? Like, what do you think we need to do differently in order to engage in its important care for you? We did that at Trinity. It was super painful and embarrassing, but really helpful. So I think the relational thing inside the church and the larger community, the institutional thing I've already spoken to, I think that there are lots of ways in your own community that you can begin to invest in repairing institutions, because the goal is not just to provide philanthropic dollars, it is to create institutions that sustain thriving communities. And then the civilizational stuff, I think that church pastors need to understand that they are stewards of an American public imagination right now, which is utterly diminished to like 140 characters. Hmm. And that right now, we essentially have our nihilist in chief in office who is reducing the public imagination to victimization and fear. And our churches need to be the places that bear witness to the reality of the triune God, to the incarnation of Jesus, to the crucifixion, the resurrection, the coming of the Holy Spirit, and the renewal of all things. And so pastors, you've got to press your people's imagination and help them reimagine this world. And so I think that those are very basic things. Mm-hmm. And I want to say that sometimes when people hear me talk about this, they get really tired. They're like, oh my gosh, I can't do all this. After a session, I just want to go take a nap. I want you to understand that this is why I did this as a testimony and not as a sermon, because I am not exhorting you to do these things. I am saying, this is what has happened to me, and these are the fumbling ways that I've gone forward. And if there's any one little node here that you can latch onto and say, yeah, I want to, I think the personal thing is really helpful, or I think I could begin to talk about, you know, some African-American theologians, or I think we could, gosh, we've got this person who just wanted to give us some local mission funds. Maybe we could partner, just take little steps And I think that you, that's really all we can do. So I don't think you need to push yourself beyond where you are spiritually right now just yet.
Great. How do we respond when MLK is often attempted to be discredited both morally and theologically?
I am familiar with that. Basically, when people talk to me about MLK, they say three things. They say, one, he was an adulterer. Two, that he was a communist. And three, that he was a theological liberal. You ever heard these? Yeah. Was he an adulterer? Yes. The evidence is unequivocal. It is also the case that this is something, this is like a, I'm not exonerating him in any way. Just contextualize it a little bit. This is a besetting, tragic sin that he himself thought made him unworthy for gospel ministry and that he confessed repeatedly. It was a source of enormous shame for him. But yes, it's true. That is true. That he was a communist, that is not true. You have to understand that African-American intellectuals in the 20th century, especially the early 20th century, saw communism not as like some pure Marxist ideology, and they had no ability to see what they would eventually come to see around the Stalinist abuses and things like that. They saw it as a promise of a post-racial society. That was the promise. And so the communists consistently tried to engage African-Americans in the United States as a part of a conflict with Western democratic capitalism. And in fact, a lot of African-American intellectuals went to Moscow in the 20th century, and they stayed for a few years and thought, we got to get out of here. This is not what it was cracked up to be. And in fact, the first known African-American communist, Lovett Fort Whiteman, in the United States, died in the Gulag. And so you've heard about African-American intellectuals going to Paris. That they all left Moscow and went to Paris. That's how that happened. And so they, but King very, very clearly, So what they were trying to do was seek a post-racial society. They became disenchanted with that pretty quickly. And King himself overtly repudiated communism repeatedly because of its materialism, its materialist account of history and its closed view of the universe, which he was very explicit about that. So no, he was not a communist. In terms of a theological liberal, the answer to that is yes and no. King grew up in the fundamentalist tradition at Ebenezer in Atlanta, and he was often embarrassed by his father's fundamentalism. But when he went to Morehouse, and then when he went to Crozier Seminary, and then when he went to Boston, he was consistently trying to distance himself from that. And early in seminary, he definitely identified with the liberal Protestant tradition. That was his thing. But it's important to understand that by the end of seminary, he was critiquing liberalism, and he was doing that largely through the resources of Niebuhr and Barth. And so he was basically saying liberalism is also an ideology, and he spent his ministry basically re-embodying his father's fundamentalism, which was something that people made fun of him about. And in fact, the black nationalist movement that emerges in the 1960s referred to him as a fundamentalist and made fun of him for that. But he basically ended up inside of this fundamentalist tradition that had a very, very strong social concern, and that he used Karl Barth and other people as a resource to try to critique the dominance of a apathetic church. So that's probably more than you wanted. I think that there are certainly some things inside of King that I don't agree with theologically. But part of the issue is we don't really know that much about what King thought in terms of a comprehensive system, because he never produced that. He never had time. He was murdered when he was 39. And he was traveling almost 300 days a year up to that, writing sermons on notepads in planes and in the backs of cars. And that's really what we have. And so my work was essentially to piece together a theology based on his writing. So there are things about his theology that I think are certainly beautiful. There are things about his theology that I think, I don't really agree with that, and I think that he probably would have changed his mind on that. But there are certainly things, like his insistence on the image of God, his belief that the triune God was going to be absolute and critique any nation that presumed absolute rule, his arguments against greed, his insistence on love of neighbor as the central of the political ethic. I think that those are fantastic theological resources, and that there's really nobody better than him on those things. Great. Helpful?
Yeah. Thanks. Yeah. So before we invite Megan Broadstreet to come up and make announcements, I have a request that if you could share with us how we can be praying for you, and then if we could close out this session with Pastor Robertson coming up to lead us in prayer.
Sure. Well, thank you for asking that. If you can imagine my life right now, my house is full of boxes. I have four children who are not happy with me. My wife and I are sleeping on a mattress in our floor. Our friends are coming to say goodbye to us on a daily basis and say goodbye to our house where many of them have slept and stayed during difficult times. And it's all in pursuit of this thing where Papa is trying to give himself to healing the central trauma of American life. It's a little complicated at home to explain. And I'm moving here in 3 weeks, and I would ask for your prayer for my children, that they would not just feel uprooted, but that they would feel and know that they are rooted in Christ, who is our life, and that he is bearing them in his own arms. So I'd appreciate prayer for them. We have a lot of details to work out about our life here. I'm going to work for this amazing woman, but I'm trying to get my kids in school. I'm trying to figure out exactly what my job is going to be. We're trying to raise capital for the play. I mean, there's just a lot going on right now. And I'd say my experience of my life, it has never been more chaotic and more serene. And I would just appreciate your prayer for God to navigate us through this and provide for us as we go forward, and also to maintain the serenity of communion with him, which is the source of all good. So I would really appreciate prayers for those things. And thank you for listening.